Hi, welcome to everyone for the virtual Math Fest 2020. And this is the symposium on algebra and number theory. And the first speaker for us today is Anand Sawant from TIFR Mumbai. And he'll speak about some applications of Motivic homotopy theory to the theory of algebraic groups. Please go ahead, Anand.
Thank you very much, Krishna. And it is my great pleasure to open this virtual Math Fest, which is taking place which has to take place virtually because of these difficult times. Well, when the organizers invited me to give a talk in this Math Fest, they gave me a very unique challenge. And in fact, they asked me to give a survey talk on my research area in 45 minutes. And secondly, they asked me to make it accessible to beginning graduate students, which is really a unique challenge. But I will try my best. So Motivic homotopy theory has a reputation of being a very technical subject. And to some extent, that is true. That is a valid complaint. But it does have a lot of concrete applications. In fact, many, and I would be touching upon on very few of those. And although, 45 minutes are not enough to do justice to even introduce even homotopy theory, what I'm going to do is give an overview of some applications to a very particular, very concrete area, and that of algebraic groups, which also has links to some classical problems in commutative algebra. And hopefully, this becomes a motivation for some of you who wants to pursue this further, just like it was for me many years ago. So, what is Motivic homotopy theory? So, as the name suggests, it's a homotopy theory for algebraic varieties. It was developed by Morell and Wojcicki in the 90s, in which the role of the unit interval is played by the affine line. Now, this is something that you find on Wikipedia or Google when you search Motivic homotopy theory. And it is going to be hard to, of course, give precise definitions and so on, but I would just say to those who are not familiar with the subject that try to take a look at the applications, and it is possible that you may not follow some of the terms and so on, but just try to get a feel of why, what they are used for. And if you pursue it further, it would definitely get better. But I'm going to keep the talk very, very non-technical and for non-experts. So the reason for the subject to have this reputation of being technical is that, of course, it's a homotopy theory for algebraic varieties. So you start with the category of algebraic varieties, and you want nice algebraic varieties. So you focus on smooth varieties. But then there are certain constructions that one has to make in order to make a homotopy theory work. What do you need? For instance, you need the notion of an interval, which the unit interval, the role which unit interval plays in usual topology. So the point about the real thing about the unit interval that makes homotopy theory kind of work is that you look at the multiplication map x, y going to xy. This gives you a homotopy between the identity map and the constant map. And what one has to observe is that this multiplication map x, y going to xy is a polynomial map, is an algebraic map. And so you can make sense of this map as a map from a1 cross a1 to a1, where a1 is the affine line over the field. And but then, of course, one has to make a lot of categorical constructions, and this is why the subject becomes technical, and you have to suitably enlarge this category, and then sheaves and so on come into picture. But we will not get into all those technicalities, but I will just say that just like you study the set of connected components and higher homotopy groups in topology, in Motivic homotopy theory or Motivic algebraic topology, you study the A1 homotopy sheaves. So these are sheaves IN given a base point, little x of x. You can talk of its nth A1 homotopy sheaf. And I'm not going to define it in this talk at all. And if some of you are interested, you can actually ask me questions about it at the end or in the chat. And by the way, let me also ask the chair to let me know if there is a question about some confusion regarding some notation or some clarification regarding some notation in one of the slides. Please feel free to interrupt and let me know.
Sure, Anand. I'll keep an eye on the chat.
Thanks a lot. I mean, or if the organizers let you know. Okay, let us try to keep it informed. So although I call this slide the teaser trailer, the real teaser trailer is the next slide. So I'm going to talk about three problems. So three problems which involve algebraic groups. These are, quite famous, well-known problems. So one is Sayre's problem on projective modules. And vector bundles on affine varieties, which is just a fancy name for projective modules on commutative rings. And then there is a famous conjecture of Murthy regarding structure of certain projective modules. And then there is a topic about, then there is a question of central extensions of algebraic groups. And in short, I have written the names of some people who have contributed to these areas from the side of motivic homotopy theory. And the reason why motivic homotopy theory comes into picture is that these problems are going to involve some of these motivic homotopy sheaves. So Sayre's problem on projective modules or homotopy invariants of G torsors, this problem is going to involve the sheaf of K1 connected components of G. Then the question of Murthy's conjecture has something to do with higher homotopy sheaves of punctured affine space. And central extensions of algebraic groups has something to do with the A1 fundamental group, whatever that means. So as I said, I'm not going to define these homotopy sheaves. I'm only going to make analogies and give you reasons to believe why looking for such generalizations and looking for certain questions, looking for certain analogs, algebraic analogs, is a reasonable thing to do. And so let me also point out for the general audience that all these three topics are completely independent of each other. I'm only going to introduce the problems and state results for each of the three problems. So in case you lose track, when I'm talking about one problem, if you lose track, just don't get disheartened. The next topic that is going to come will have nothing to do with the previous talk. And of course, so I hope that helps. So I'm going to start with the last one first, central extensions of algebraic groups, because the topic is, to introduce it is kind of elementary, and it's also slightly independent of the other two. The other two are to some extent related in the sense that they both originate out of or concern problems regarding projective modules. So let us just start with some basic algebra, and let us start with a group G and an abelian group A. And what is a central extension of G by A? So it's an exact sequence of groups of the form as written 1A to E to G to 1. So this just means that all these A, E and G are groups. I and P are group homomorphisms. And the image of I is kernel of P. That is the meaning of exact. And also that A injects into E and E surjects onto G. And you say that, so of course, if you were not given any condition about this, so you were just given an exact sequence, you would call E an extension of G by A. You say that the extension is central if the abelian group A is contained in the center of E. Okay, so that's kind of easy to, it's a simple definition. And now once you are given central extensions, you can actually define what it means to be a map or a morphism of central extensions. And the notation and the notion is quite clear. If you're given two central extensions, AE and A prime E prime, a morphism of central extensions should be a pair of commutative, a pair of group homomorphisms F and G. So F is a group homomorphism from A to A prime, G is a group homomorphism from E to A prime, E prime, and this obvious commutative, obvious diagram should commute. Okay, so you put G to G as identity, it's equality. Okay, so if this diagram commutes, then you have a morphism of central extensions. Now, once you have defined this notion, one can also talk about universal properties when one talks about categories. So are there some special central extensions? and which admit a certain property with respect to morphisms. And so these are called universal central extensions. So a central extension is said to be universal if given any central extension, this one admits a unique map morphism to that. Okay, so the definition is abstract, of course, and but there is a very simple fact which goes back to Schur, more than the work of Schur, more than 100 years ago, I think. And it says that a group G admits a universal central extension if and only if it is perfect. That means G equals its own commutator subgroup. So of course, this was a theorem 100 years ago, but now it's really an easy exercise for a beginning graduate student interested in algebra. Okay, I'm not going to do it for you, but I'm going to, let me just say a few words about it. So the idea, I mean, in order to get a universal central extension, what you do is start with a free presentation of the group and then take commutators and play with it so that and use the condition G equal to its own commutator to arrive at a universal central extension. That's the hint I would give for those who are really going to do this exercise. And the converse is actually quite interesting. So you have to, I mean, if G is perfect, you can admit a universal central extension by looking at the free presentation and then playing with commutators. The other way, if you are given that group admits a universal central extension, you have to show that it is perfect. This is quite interesting. So you assume that it is not perfect, then its commutator subgroup is non-trivial. And then you can cook up some extensions which actually contradict the definition of universality, that there exists a unique morphism from the universal one. So I'm not going to say much, but I will just give you a hint, and which will also serve as a trivial example of central extension. So how do you get trivially central extensions? You are given a group G and you are given an abelian group A. You just take the Cartesian product, A cross G. That's an easy central extension, which is a trivial central extension, but there are many non-trivial ones. And if G is not perfect, then G modulo its commutator is a non-trivial abelian group. So you take this as A and take the trivial central extension and then try and play with it. Anyway, I will just say this much. But what I'm interested in more is to look at the set of isomorphism classes of central extensions of G by A. Okay, so one can actually check that this forms a group. And so I'm not going to discuss this at all, but I will just say that the group operation is given by what is called Bayer sum. So if you're interested, you can look this up. And then there is a very interesting question which was asked in the 50s. And well, I will just tell you where one is coming from. I mean, of course, one thinks of a fundamental group when one is talking about topology. But here we have no topology, we just have abstract groups. So you can look at this functor, central extensions from G from some abelian group, and you can let the abelian group vary. And you can ask if this functor is representable. If you can ask if this functor is representable by an abelian group. Okay, and if this functor is representable, then you call the representing abelian group the fundamental group of G and call it pi 1 G. So what is the meaning of representability? This means for any abelian group A, the group of central extensions, isomorphism classes of central extensions of G by A, this is the HOMS of groups from pi 1 G to A. Okay, and yeah, so of course, I mean, one of the difficulties in giving an online talk is that you don't have a feedback, but I hope the definition is fairly clear from up to this point. But what I wanted to point out is that, I mean, pi 1 G, so the fundamental group can, I mean, one can think of the fundamental group in a purely algebraic way. And I will say in a moment why it is consistent with topology. So suppose you are in a topological scenario, you work with a topological group, or let's say connected Lie group, then its universal central extension is actually given by its universal cover in the sense of topology. one can show that it is also a topological group, it's a Lie group actually, and it is the universal central extension with the kernel given by the topological fundamental group. And so there is a notion of this in topology, and the topological pi 1 fits this notion, and hence you can abstractify it and bring it to algebra. And as you can see the title of the slide, I want to talk about Matsumoto's theorem, and here's where algebraic groups will come into picture. So what is an algebraic group? So it's just a group which can be defined by vanishing of certain polynomial equations. So these are groups which can make sense, groups which can make sense of sense as objects in algebraic geometry. For instance, if you look at the group GLN, it's an algebraic group because GLN is defined by the condition that a matrix is invertible if its determinant is non-trivial. And so a matrix can be seen as a polynomial a matrix can be seen as a vector if your matrix is of the size n cross n, you can see this as a vector in n square dimensional space, the xijs being the variables, and the determinant of this variable matrix xij is going to be a polynomial, and just the fact that the determinant is invertible can be expressed by the equation determinant of this matrix xij times y equal to 1. So for instance, if you are having SLN, which is the special linear group, which is given by the condition that the determinant is 1, then the determinant equal to 1 is a polynomial equation whose zero set is SLN. And similarly for the special orthogonal group and many others, symplectic group, exceptional groups, you can write them as zero sets of some polynomial equations. Now I'm going to go into algebraic groups. I'm going to put a lot of hypotheses just because I want to reach the theorem very quickly, but just don't worry about the hypothesis. So if G be a simple, split, semi-simple, almost simple, simply connected algebraic group over an infinite field. So, if you're not familiar with algebraic group theory, there's no need to worry about these notions. But I will just say that the examples that one has in mind are SLN. So GLN is not an example here because it is not semi-simple. So roughly speaking, a group will be semi-simple if it is perfect in some sense. Okay, so SLN is perfect, GLN is not, but SLN is the semi-simple part of GLN. The symplectic group SP2N is also an example of this group. The special orthogonal group, SON, is not an example because it is not simply connected. And simply connected in the algebraic group theory sense means that it does not admit any non-trivial covers, vaguely speaking. But SON does. You have the spin group, spin N, is a double cover of SON. And so spin N is the simply connected group, SON is not. Okay, so these are just some examples. Keep them in mind. There is actually a classification which goes into the letters A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Some examples to keep in mind for such groups are SLN, the symplectic group, the spin groups, or the exceptional groups, the simply connected exceptional groups. And the theorem of Matsumoto says the following. So, of course, as I said, semi-simplicity in some sense means that the group of k rational points of G is a perfect group. And so by the theorem of Schur, it admits a universal central extension. So let A, E, G, K, so there is a one missing there, that's a typo. Let this be a universal central extension. Then there was a lot of work on this in the 60s. Actually in the early 60s, Steinberg gave a description of the group E by generators and relations, and that's why it is actually called the Steinberg group. And Matsumoto gave a description of the kernel A by generators and relations. And of course, I don't have that much space, so I'm not going to give the whole generators and relations. I'm going to give the modern names for these groups. And the modern names are the second Milner K theory and second Milner Witt K theory. And so there is an interesting dichotomy here. So what Matsumoto's theorem says is that if the group is not of symplectic type, so So if you follow the classification of split semi-simple, almost simple algebraic groups, then symplectic type is the type CN. So if the group is not of this symplectic type, then the central extension, no matter what the group is, the central extension is the second Milner K group of the field K. And I'm going to define this on the next slide. And if G is of symplectic type, it is a bit bigger. It is not the K2 Milner. It is what is called K2 Milner Witt. And this is a new notion. It has, come into picture, let's say maybe only 10 years ago, 10, 15 years ago, not more than that. But of course, the group was well known at the time of Matsumoto. He studied it by generators and relations. So, but the point here to understand is that the group A is kind of independent of G. It is only depending upon the type. So for instance, if you took SL2, it is also of symplectic type because SL2 is also isomorphic to SP2. So its kernel of the universal central extension is going to be K Milner with 2. But the same is going to be the case for SP2N for any N. And that is quite surprising. And also, for instance, if you take SLN for N greater than 2, it's not of symplectic type. It's kernel or the so-called algebraic fundamental group is going to be the same as the one for spin N or for the exceptional groups. So it's quite strong. And so let me come to what these groups are. So the Milner K theory of a field K is the associative graded ring defined as follows. So you take the tensor algebra on K star. So K star is the multiplicative group of the field. It's an abelian group. So you can see that as a Z module, and you can look at the tensor algebra. So in degree zero, it is Z. In degree one, it is K star. In degree two, it is K star tensor K star over Z, and so on. And then you go modulo the ideal generated by elements of the form X tensor one minus X. Okay, and you take the two-sided ideal generated by this, you take the quotient, you started with a graded ring, the tensor algebra is a graded ring, and this is a homogeneous element, so you would get a graded ring after taking quotients, and then, so you can write this as the direct sum of K Milner N in degree N for N greater than or equal to 0. For N less than 0, the groups are 0. Okay, so one thing to observe is that in low degrees, so K0 is just Z and K1 of K is just K star. This is because there are no relations in degree less than 2. Okay, so the only relations are coming from X tensor 1 minus X, and this is an element of degree 2. So there are no relations for smaller degrees. And so these are, so K0 and K1 agree with the groups in the coming in the tensor algebra, but one has to keep in mind that K1 is written additively. So if you are looking at the symbol XY in the tensor algebra, it is equal to X plus Y in the tensor algebra. Because if you write the symbol of X times symbol of Y, it would mean kind of the symbol in degree two. Okay, so, and of course, K2 onwards, you get non-trivial groups. So let me just remark that this relation X tensor 1 minus X equal to 0 is called the Steinberg relation. And Milner-Witt K theory, so I'm not going to define it explicitly. It was introduced by Hopkins and Morell when this even homotopy theory was developed. So it is also an associative graded ring, and it contains an element eta of degree minus 1. So it is also in negative degrees. But when you mod out by this eta, you get Milner K theory. That's the relationship. And we are not going to use this very explicitly. So this is just to have some idea about it. So this Milner-Witt K theory is to be seen as some sort of enrichment of Milner K theory. And the enrichment comes from the data about quadratic forms over the field K. And so I will not go into details. I'm just using these words so that if you're interested in these kind of areas, you might find it interesting to pursue. Okay, so I want to talk about the Motivic, so-called Motivic version of Matsumoto's theorem, and it involves, first of all, sheafifying these constructions. So on the previous slide, I spoke about Miller K theory of a field, and the definition is kind of algebraic. It's easy to understand. For any smooth variety, you want a definition of Miller K theory of that. Okay, and then there is a standard process for doing that. So, and the process is as follows. So you start with a smooth variety over a field K, and then you look at its function field, that is Kx. Okay, and now you look at points of codimension 1, and each of them define a valuation on this function field, such that the residue field of the valuation is the residue field of the point that you have taken, that is K of little x on the right hand side in the slide there. And one can show that there exist residue homomorphisms in Milner K theory. They go from Kn of the quotient field to Kn minus 1 of the residue field. And so by taking all these points of codimension 1, you build all these residue maps, and then you take the kernel of this, and then you define this as the so-called unramified Milner K theory sheaf. Okay. And you can define the unramified Milner-Witt K theory sheaf similarly. And so it's just that you have to replace this Kn Milner by Kn Milner-Witt, and you have to take the residue maps for Milner-Witt K theory. Of course, one has to be a bit careful in the construction of this residue maps and properties of these residue maps, but I'm going to shove all that under the carpet today. But I'm going to just mention the word that the complex that is used to define this, so it's called the Rost-Schmidt complex. So for instance, you have this Kn going to Kn minus 1 of the residue fields of codimension 1 points. You can go further. You can then go to the direct sum over codimension 2 points, and then you take the n minus second Milner K theory of the residue fields of those points, and then you can go further and further. This gives you a complex. This is called the Rost-Schmidt complex. I mean, for Milner K theory or for Milner-Witt K theory, depending upon the sheaf that you have. And then here is a Motivic version of Matsumoto's theorem, which is obtained in a joint work with Fabian Morel. The preprint is not online yet. It's going to be on archive very soon, perhaps by the end of this month or early next month. And it says that if G is a group, an algebraic group as above with all those decorations, but over an arbitrary field now, then there exists an isomorphism of sheaves, pi 1, a1 of G, whatever that fundamental group sheaf means. But then you get the answer exactly analogous to the simple case, but in the sheaf version. If G is not of symplectic type, you get the unramified Milner K2 sheaf. And if G is of symplectic type, you get the unramified Milner-Witt K2 sheaf. And so I want to point out why Matsumoto considers only infinite fields and why we consider arbitrary fields. So basically, Matsumoto considers infinite fields because for finite fields, if you look at K2 of a finite field, it is trivial. So you don't really get anything new. Okay, so let me just go back to Matsumoto's theorem, the statement of Matsumoto's theorem, which I had a few slides back. I hope it is visible now. So if you take the group of K points, and if your field is finite, then the group A is going to be trivial because Milner K2 and Milner-Witt K2 of a finite field are both trivial. So you don't get really interesting central extensions. And I mean, for Matsumoto, naturally, finite fields were not very interesting. But of course, I mean, it doesn't mean that. Of course, there are several technical constraints. I mean, so there are several technical difficulties, but they can be overcome. You can work over an arbitrary field and get an analog of these results. But I want to point out that even over finite fields, you get new results because although your field is finite, there can be field extensions which are not finite, and or you can have algebras over finite field. And for them, the unramified K2 can be non-trivial. And so this theorem, even in the finite case gives some new information. So the next slide is going to be a bit technical, but I'm going to very quickly touch upon what are applications of this kind of a result and what is their significance. So the idea, I mean, why one, I mean, one motivation for to be interested in this group pi 1 is that you can actually compute the first cohomology of G in with coefficients in a nice sheaf. So I'm not going to talk in detail about what nice means, but nice actually means A1 homotopy invariant or strictly A1 homotopy invariant. You can look up those words on Google if you're interested. And so if you are given a nice sheaf, then you can actually compute this cohomology and you can get an explicit formula. Now, in this explicit formula, I'm using a gadget which I have not defined, which is this funny F subscript minus 2. And you can see that, I mean, you can kind of get an idea that, so pi 1 had something to do with K2 and this minus 2 had something to do with that 2. And that is true. And also the eta, the little eta that is coming in eta torsion is because K2 Milner can be obtained as K2 Milner with modulo eta. And the connecting link, which I'm not written and which I'm not going to go into, is that this cohomology group, this first cohomology group, H1GF, can actually be seen as HOM from pi 1 A1 of G into F in the category of nice sheaves. So of course, there are lots of things like pi 1 A1 of G is a nice sheaf and so on and so forth, but let's forget that. I mean, one doesn't really have to understand this statement. All that one has to take away from this slide is that if you're interested in computing cohomology, then this is also a way to compute. This also gives you an explicit formula. And let me just, for the sake of completeness, give you the definition of this F minus 2. It's actually a very natural construction. So if you are given a sheaf F, what you do is you define F minus 1 to be, so you evaluate this F on X cross GM. So GM is the multiplicative group. You evaluate it on F on X. So for instance, if my X were an affine scheme, say spec of a commutative ring A, then X cross GM would just correspond to the Laura polynomial ring ATT inverse. And so this map would be just F of ATT inverse going to F of A, where you set T equal to 1. That's the evaluation map. And you take the kernel and you define it to be minus 1. And then you define minus 2 to be minus 1 of minus 1. That's a natural definition. And these kind of cohomology computations were available in various cases in history. So Brilinsky and Delin had a lot of, Brilinsky and Delin, of course, was one of the first works where they computed the H1 of G with coefficients in K2. And in fact, this is what they use in their results. So I'm going to very briefly touch up upon the work of Brilinsky and Delin without going into details. But then Eno, Kahn, Levine, and Feweg around 20 years ago computed this cohomology for some nicer sheaves, so which go by the name Ross cycle modules in this area. And they had a formula for it. And their formula actually did not show any dichotomy. So their formula was that if F is what is called Ross cycle module, then H1 G with coefficients in F is just F minus 2 of K, depending for arbitrary G. But what happens is that these Ross cycle modules, whatever they are such that the action of eta on them is trivial, whatever that means. And hence, eta torsion is the whole of the sheaf. And hence, they did not get this dichotomy. The first time the dichotomy was kind of observed was in the work of Stefan Gille, when he computed this cohomology group for of G with coefficients in the unramified Witt sheaf of quadratic forms. And there he got some dichotomy. and this was kind of not understood why the dichotomy comes, and so this work kind of uniformly explains and generalizes these computations. And there are several other applications which one can give, and yeah, you can look at the paper whether it comes online or just ask me. Okay, so this is kind of the end of first part. So I mean, let me know if there are some questions or if people have some people would like to have certain clarifications, and I'm now going to move to the next part. Okay, so I guess we started around 4 or 5 minutes late, so I have 10 more minutes, right?
Yeah, sure, you have around maybe 12, 13, 15 minutes.
Okay, I'll take less, it's not So okay, so I'm going to talk about Serre's problem on projective modules. So it's a kind of it's a very well-known famous problem. It was stated in 1955. It just says that if you take a field and if you take a finitely generated projective module on the polynomial ring, is it free? And as many of you will know, this was answered in the affirmative by Quillen and Suslin independently in 1976. And one can generalize this. So you can talk about a smooth affine algebra over a field, and you can talk about finitely generated projective modules on the polynomial ring over A. And the analog of this question is that do they come from A? So if a finitely generated projective module on the polynomial ring over a field comes from field, so all the projective modules over fields are, I mean, they are just free. And so the right analog of this question is that does there exist a projective A module P prime such that P is obtained by tensoring P prime by this polynomial ring? And the answer to this question is also affirmative due to Linde in 1981. And actually, although this is a question about projective modules, there is an algebraic group lurking there, and that algebraic group is GLN. So so the dictionary between algebra and geometry tells us that projective A modules of rank N just correspond to rank N vector bundles on spec A, and rank N vector bundles are just principal GLN bundles. And one can ask the analog of Serre's problem for principal G bundles, for an arbitrary G. So you replace this G, GLN, by an arbitrary algebraic group. Okay, and I will just very vaguely say what a G torsor or a principal G bundle is. So it's just another scheme with a G action which admits a morphism to X, and such that Zariski locally it should look like X cross G to X, okay, where the action of G is only on the right factor. Okay, so that's a very vague definition. It just means that given any point in X, you can find an open set such that restricted to that open set, this principal bundle has this very simple form. Okay, and one fact is that G torsors are classified by, or isomorphism classes of them are classified by, the cohomology group H1 Zar. So Zar is for Zariski topology, X with coefficients in G. So don't confuse this with the H1G with coefficients in something on the previous set of problems. Okay, this is just a question about G bundles. And one can ask this question, that you have a finite type smooth K algebra, you take the spectrum of that to be U, and then the projection map U cross A1 to U induces a map from H1UG to H1U cross A1G. And is this an isomorphism? Okay, so that's the obvious generalization. And the answer is it's not always an isomorphism. And it is classically known that one has to impose some sort of isotropy hypothesis for the above question to have an affirmative answer. So isotropy hypothesis. So what does one mean by isotropy? So I'll come to that on the next side. So the first counter examples were given by Ohanguren and Sridharan in 1971. So their example for this to be failing, for this question to have a negative answer, the group that was involved was SL1 of a division algebra, which is not a field. And so then Parimala found another very interesting example in 1978. So this is about SO4 of an anisotropic quadratic form over real numbers. So why, I mean, this group? So when you are talking about principal bundles for SO of quadratic form, you can rephrase these questions about projective modules with a quadratic form on them. And this was one of the open questions at that time. And yeah, so, and yeah, and it was answered negatively by Parimala. So I see that there's a question in the chat. I will address that at the end, the question answer session. So Raghunathan introduced the following isotropy hypothesis in 1989, and he had by far a very general result regarding this affine homotopy invariance of G torsors. And this will look a very technical sentence. Every almost K simple component of the derived group of G contains a K subgroup scheme isomorphic to GM. So the idea is that you start with an algebraic group, you take its kind of commutator with itself. That is the derived group, that is the semi-simple part. So you look at that, and if that contains a copy of GM, then you say that it's isotropic. So for instance, SL2, I'll just give you as an example, is isotropic. It is given by matrices A, B, C, D such that AD minus BC is equal to 1, but then it has this a copy of GM which sits diagonally as A 0 0 A inverse, where A is a non-trivial element of K. Okay, and what Raghunathan proved was that if G satisfies the isotropy hypothesis, then you have this affine homotopy invariance over fields. And he also obtained counterexamples after putting a very technical condition, which I can write because this is an online talk. Don't worry about this condition. It's a bit technical. It's difficult to check. I mean, it can be checked, but for each group, you have to check it separately. And the contribution of motivic homotopy theory, which is, of course, which comes after the work of many, many people, Morel, Schlichting, Ashok Thoyova, and Wendt, and some joint work of myself with Chetan Balwe, is that over a perfect field, for a reductive group G, one gets a very clean sentence, a very clean statement. You just get that the following are equivalent. G satisfies Raghunathan's isotropy hypothesis if and only if the analog of Searle's problem is true. And the way this is done is by showing that these two are isomorphic, these two are equivalent to a third statement, which is very intrinsic to A1 homotopy theory. So I am not going to go into the details, but this Singh A1 that you see is just the analog of the cellular chain complex as you see in topology. In topology, given a topological or singular chain complex, given a topological space, you can form a singular chain complex and then its homology is the singular homology. So you can do that kind of a thing algebraically in this A1 homotopy theory, and then you get this object. And A1 locality is a kind of is a property, which I will not go into. But I said on the teaser trailer slide that this has something to do with pi 0 A1. And what does it have to do? So, this goes by showing that both 1 and 2 are equivalent to 3. And so the equivalence of 2 and 3 is kind of a formal thing. Of course, modulo very difficult results of Foliothelian and Ohanguren and Raghunathan and so on. So this was kind of, my first idea about this came in the work of Schlichting on, in the case G equal to GLN. Morel had done this theorem when K is infinite perfect, characteristic not 2, and G is GLN for N not equal to 2. And then Schlichting addressed the case of all GLN, but in his proof, he had the key idea which makes the proof of two equivalent to 3 work. And then this was exploited by Ashok Hoiwa and went to obtain the theorem in generality. And Ashok Hoiwa and went also proved 1 equal to 3. And the statement 3 equal to 1 was proved in my joint work with Chetan Balwe. So the idea is that the statement, if you assume this statement 3, it implies that if you look at this pi 0 a1 of G, and if you look at its sections over K, this is just G K, the K rational points of G modulo naive a1 homotopies. So two points are equivalent if they're connected by a1, and then you can extend this, you take the equivalence relation generated by this. And then 1, 2, 3 implies 1 by showing that if G does not satisfy the isotropy hypothesis, then this cannot happen. Then pi naught a1 cannot agree with this GK modulo naive a1 homotopy. So the idea, main idea is that if you look at anisotropic groups, they do not have non-trivial maps from affine line into it. So an example of anisotropic group is SU2 of R. And if you take this SU2 of R, it has no maps from A1 into it. So SU2 of R modulo naive A1 homotopies would be SU2 of R. But you can check that pi 0 A1 of that is trivial. So that is the kind of idea. And so now I'm going to move to the last topic. And very vaguely, so this, of course, I kept the most technical part for the last at the end. And in the last 2 minutes, I hope I have 2 or 3 minutes, and I will be addressing this very fast. And of course, this part is a bit technical, but at least the question is very interesting. And I think that should be the takeaway, not the methods. So you start with a smooth affine variety, and you look at the set of isomorphism classes of rank R vector bundles on X. And so rank R vector bundles is just a fancy way of saying rank R projective modules on A, where X is spec A. So now you can take a rank R vector bundle, take direct sum with OX, the trivial vector bundle, and you get a rank R plus one vector bundle. So similarly, you take a projective module, you just take direct sum with A, you get a projective module of rank one more. And the question asked by Bas was that, what is the image of this natural map? And Ser, in fact, before Bas posed the question, had shown that this is surjective if R is greater than or equal to D, where D is the dimension of X. Okay, so in other words, projective module of rank greater than or equal to D plus 1 always admits a trivial rank one somehow. And then there was a lot of work in the... So the question is much harder to address when R is less than D. So the first non-trivial case is R equal to D minus 1. And in this case, of course, it is not surjective, but you can explicitly determine the image. So the image was determined in the work of Murthy and Swan in 1976, which, they handled the case D equal to 2, Mohan Kumar and Murthy D equal to 3, and then Murthy in general, that if K is algebraically closed, then the image is precisely those vector bundles which have non-trivial top churn class in the Chow group. So I'm not going to define churn classes, but just keep in mind that it's an invariant of a vector bundle or a projective module, which takes values in. You can look at churn classes in various cohomology theories, whatever they mean, you choose the Chow groups. And Murthy conjectured that a projective module of rank D minus 1 splits off a trivial rank 1 sum if and only if its top churn class is 0. So note that the previous theorem was for rank D. Okay, so he asked the analog of the same question for D minus 1. And in other words, he was just asking if image of SD minus 2X is precisely those vector bundles with top churn class 0. And this is what A1 homotopy theory has managed to achieve. So this is the theorems of Ashok and Fasel. They say that if the characteristic is not 2 and K is algebraically closed, of course, and D is less than or equal to 4, then Murthy's conjecture holds. And for D equal to 3, they even have a much stronger result. So they actually show that rank 2 vector bundles are precisely classified by churn classes. First churn class into the Chow 1 and the second churn class into the Chow 1. Okay, so that's the flavor of arguments. And now I'm going to very quickly, in a minute, I'm out of time actually, just explain the approach. So the approach is that you can write vector bundles, the class of the set of isomorphism classes of rank n vector bundles, as A1 homotopy classes of maps from X into a scheme like object, and that's the infinite Grassmannian. And this infinite Grassmannian, for those who are familiar with classifying spaces, they are just the classifying space of GLM, BGLM. And then there is a natural map from BGL, n minus 1 to GL, BGLN, which corresponds to the natural map from GLN minus 1 to GLN. And then one uses machinery called Posnikov towers from algebraic topology to use this. So the idea, the way this works, is that, of course, your vector bundle is going to correspond to a map X to BGLN, which I have written as gamma, and you are interested in when it lifts to BGLN minus 1. So the idea is that, so this is just the topological obstruction theory, which tells you that this lift exists if certain cohomologic classes with coefficients in the homotopy groups of the fiber vanish. So here the fiber is this punctured affine space, and then you get this homotopy, this cohomology classes in question. There are certain cohomology classes. We don't have to understand this at all. I'm just want to give a flavor of arguments. And one just has to keep in mind that this is just Zariski cohomology and it's going to vanish beyond the dimension of X. So we are only, reduced to studying this for I less than or equal to D minus 1. And then there are results of Morel, as well as Ashok Fasel and Ashok Fasel Williams, which tell you what this, which compute what this sheaf is. And so what Morel shows is that if you start with zero and go up to n minus two, this pi i's are always vanishing for a n minus zero. And the first non-trivial one is the Milner-Witt Kn that we met some slides ago. And then Ashok and Fasel's, the crux of the proof was to understand what happens at the critical stage pi 3 of a 3 minus 0, and then they obtained a formulation in terms of some Milner K theory and some Grothendieck Witt groups, which are some groups involving some quadratic forms, and we'll not go into the details, but this is just an idea. And recently, this exact equality was not needed for the theorem of Ashok and Fasel. They only needed a weaker statement. This exactness of this precise, this exact sequence in this precise form was obtained by Ashok Fasel and Williams, and this paper has just appeared earlier this year in the literature. So anyway, that's all I had to say. And to end, I just want to say that, this was just a glimpse of a very small part of unstable even homotopy theory. There is much, much more. There is a lot more to see, and I'm just putting this slide out so that if people are interested, they can look up these names. Thank you very much, and sorry for going over time. Yeah, I can answer.
Thank you. Thank you, Anand. So let's start with maybe the questions on the chat. Can you see, yeah. Anand?
Yes, I can see questions on the chat. So I'll just go from, yes, last to first, because because the last thing came more recently. Yeah, okay. So so the singular chain complex is, it is actually a complex. It's not in a particular dimension. So you have to take the whole complex, and you have to actually enlarge the category to allow you to take such objects. So the way even homotopy theory works is that instead of smooth schemes, you have to look at sheaves represented by them, and then you embed them into simplicial sheaves. So at each non-negative integer, each non-negative integer corresponds to a level, and at each level there is a sheaf. So this way you can look at the whole complex and put it in this framework and take a look at it. So that is just the idea. You can look at the papers of Morel, Wojcicki, or even the books or papers on even homotopy theory for precise definition, or just email them. Okay, so there is this question I see about Matsumoto's theorem. So by the way, is this question answered? If it is not answered, then just let me know in the chat. But so there is this question by Mihir Sheth about Matsumoto's theorem. So the whole point is that topological fundamental group has nothing to do with this abstract algebraic notion which I spoke about. So, and which is why I actually introduced pi 1 g abstractly. So let me just go back to this theorem. So I introduced this pi 1 this way because this is not equal to the topological pi 1. In fact, even in Matsumoto's theorem, you don't get the topological pi 1. And this is exactly why, the point was that, and that's why it's a bit misleading. So for instance, simple connectedness in the sense of algebraic groups is very different compared to simple connectedness in topology. And hence, in fact, motivic homotopy theory is the real analog. I mean, is the real realm in which you can really see these results as analogs of. Actually, this pi 1g, I mean, because of the analogy with Lie groups, this was actually called the fundamental group, the algebraic fundamental group or topological fundamental group of a group which does not have any topology on it by Calvin Moore and these people. And in fact, this work with Morel actually shows that the motivic homotopy theory is the right topological analog of these algebraic phenomena. I hope that answers the question. So then the question was on slide 8 about X superscript 1, that is just the points of codimension 1. So if you are actually working with an affine scheme, so let's say X is equal to spec A, then they would just correspond to height 1 prime ideals. That's it. And then you look at the residue field of that. So then I said, then there is a question about central extensions being an abelian group. So it is called Bayer sum, and I am writing the spelling out in chat. So you can see in the chat that, so the spelling of Bayer. So it's a standard construction from homological algebra. So then there is a question about so the question is X2 going to this actually A1 homotopy invariant? So I don't understand the question. The invariant in X or? But anyway, yeah, so let me just say very quickly that it's very important that X is affine here. So if X is not affine on P1 cross A1, you can find a bundle which on zero section, I mean, does not come from, I mean, it's different from P1 from one section. I mean, that kind of thing. So it's very, one has to be a bit careful. But of course, when you take, Okay, Krishna, there were some questions. Or you had some comments?
Yeah, so there are a couple of other questions, but we also should be wrapping up because the next talk is at 11. Yeah. So, I mean, do you see maybe you want to say about...
I will just very quickly say the question.
There is a question about... the question
of Shikha.
Yeah.
So I'll just very... Milner K theory, she was basically... So Matsumoto's result was given in terms of generators and relations. And Milner actually defined it, this K2, the year after. And it was actually, the definition was from Matsumoto's theorem. And it comes from this definition of algebraic K theory via Steinberg groups. And as I said, sometime back very quickly, so the middle one E was the middle group E was the presentation was given by Steinberg, and K2 in algebraic K theory was kind of thought as kernel of the Steinberg map. And so Milner was just copying this definition algebraically after building on Matsumoto's theorem.
So there's also one more question, maybe this is the last you can
so
take.
I see the question. But I actually, I mean, it's a very vague question. So about tackling the classification problem, of course, there are wide range of invariants. But as this slide shows, you can get, of course, I mean, the cohomology groups are hard to understand. But you actually, I mean, even homotopy theory actually gives you a precise set of invariants. So this obstruction theory in topology that I spoke about actually gives you this whole bunch of invariants, this HI plus 1, X, and so on. So those cohomology groups actually gives you a set of D plus 1 invariants going from H0 to HD. and it's just about understanding them, how complicated they are.
Okay, so thank you, Anand. We can't really say
yeah.
at coffee time, ask the speaker questions, but maybe they can contact you if people have questions. But yeah, thanks again yeah. for a very nice talk.
Thank you very much. And please feel free to contact me by email. If you
yeah. yeah. So
thank you very much.
Thank you. Bye-bye.